I feel nervous because we've never had a guest on.
I'm excited. Yeah,
cool. I can't wait for Connor to just carry this show.
And over to you.
I'm actually trying to look up like Tarantino like facts right now to be like, so I don't come across like a dickhead.
Oh, do you want to hear something? Do you want to hear something? Joe, how many pages do you have open?
None.
You see, what a dick.
Unbelievable.
I wish I had your mind, Joe.
Yeah. I think this is the first week I haven't had notes, and I always have to have notes.
Joe's mind is like a great tome. Mine's just like a sieve.
Oh,
mine's
like a fucking tangent city where I go, oh, by the way, did you know?
If you guys are saying like yours is like a sieve or it doesn't hold, mine's just the hoop and nothing in between. There's just space. Yeah, that's mine.
Shall we begin?
Shall we begin?
Let us begin.
Hello, you. Welcome back to 8-Bit Popcorn with myself, Joe, Ryan, and Zara. This week we have a very special guest, and no, it's not like those times where Ryan claimed Christopher Nolan will be joining us. Suffice to say, that bridge is burned. So joining us is Connor Finn. Say something clever, Connor.
Wow. I was just trying to hold in my laughter there, because I don't think this is the first time they've ever been introduced in a show. It's the first time that I don't have the opportunity to just ramble on absolute bullshit. But Hiya, my name's Connor. That's my introduction.
Okay. Usually Joe has something really very intro. Elegant, and that there was just so out of sorts for me.
I'm being professional, right?
Okay. Oh my God, I love how relaxed Joe is.
So Connor comes all the way from his podcast, Finterviews. So rather than me like second-handedly describing your podcast, why don't you tell her two listeners what your show is about?
Three, Joe, come on.
Three. Oh yeah, I forgot.
Well, okay. you've just got another one. My mom will probably listen to this because she's my one listener. So
Zara's dad listens as well, so we are aware of parents listening.
Oh wow, well there we go. You're using my own trick against me. My podcast, Finterviews. That's what I do. I am usually on the opposite end of the table, usually interviewing people. So this is quite a turn up. Rather than a car, I don't know why I was trying to make like a vegetable pun there. This is me so uncomfortable, literally being like on the end where I'm not controlling everything. So yeah, I'm very happy to be a guest on the show. Yeah, let's see how well I fare up against these three, podcast legends at this stage. My God.
Absolute connoisseurs. Yeah.
Apparently, there's only two legends on this show, and I can tell you why I have yet to attain the status of legend, because I don't have a master's.
It's true.
I just have one of those silly BAs.
Oh, sorry, I misspoke. I meant the two legends on the podcast. Sorry, Ryan, that's absolutely my fault.
Oh, yeah. Right. Yes.
Yeah.
Do you have a master's, Connor, at all? Do you?
Do you know what? I don't really like to talk about that. I mean, I think it's just a bit classist, but each to their
master's
own.
Masters and bullshit, probably, yeah.
Well, yeah, that's basically it.
Who wants to be part of the lower classes of BA, but.
Wait, what was the master's in?
Media and broadcast production.
Oh, that's a nice title.
Was it same with yourself, Zara?
Mine was film and visual arts.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah. And Christopher Nolan.
And Christopher Nolan.
And Christopher Nolan, of course.
By the way.
That was my side project.
No, he's not coming on the show.
Ryan.
Dun, da, da, da.
He's done with me. Zara and him broke up a while back anyway, so it's all
right. We're done.
So, Finterviews. Very clever name, Connor Finn. I get it.
Wow.
I get it. So, you interview people.
Yes.
So since you interview people, can I interview you for a second?
Absolutely. Go for
it. Exciting.
Okay. Welcome. I've got some very pertinent questions here.
Shoot.
How are you?
I'm great. Thank you. How are you?
Yeah. What's your favorite color?
My favorite color is green at the moment, but it used to be blue.
Oh, okay. Kind of like Ireland, actually.
I was just thinking that. Yeah, typical.
Did you know Ireland's national color is actually blue?
I did not.
Green.
That's why I'm wearing blue. That's why I'm wearing blue.
Obviously, yes. Ryan. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And cats are dogs.
That's a big one.
I mean, that's every day is a school day. Yeah.
That's not an answer. That's not an answer.
So, oh, sorry. I thought you said cats are dogs. And I was oh, this is like news to me.
Getting that philosophical yet, Connor. Okay, calm down. We're just breaking you in at the minute. So cats are dogs.
Cats are dogs. Well, I'm actually a cat person, but I'm 40. Not by choice, by the way. I feel like I have to, put this into context. We were just never allowed dogs when we were growing up, so I've just been subjected to cats, and now I feel like that's where I have to rule with now. Oh, okay. Yeah, you can make fair your enough. Own judgment about that. Yeah,
I will. So who is your favorite media theory philosopher / practitioner?
Karl Marx. Go.
Interesting choice. Yeah, that was quick. So anyway, now that we've gotten to know Connor, a little bit more. And this week we're talking about Quentin Tarantino, because why not, So Zara, ladies first, because I feel like after last week's inclusion and representation and equality chats, I should positively discriminate against you.
So. Positively discriminate against me and let me go first because I have a vagina. Love that.
Exactly.
Not wow! Right,
we have presumed. Yes, Zara's yet to.
Well, she just stated it. So.
Yep. Well, I met myself, but that's all right.
Just presume my gender.
That's so true. So not even giving the guest the first chance to speak.
I know, right? I feel like that's. Oh, should hand it over to Connor.
Fine, Connor. please can start. Don't. What's your favorite Tarantino movie?
I'd like to pass the question on to Zara, please.
Okay, so my favorite Tarantino film is Hateful Eight.
Okay.
And the reason for this is because it was the first Tarantino film I saw. And yes, you have that right. I went to see Hateful Eight at the cinema, and I hadn't seen any other Tarantino films in my life. So,
but you're obviously very aware.
I was very aware because I studied film and I was around a lot of people who really loved his work and told me a lot about his work and really hyped it up. And then I feel like when I watched Pulp Fiction, I was like, oh, is that it? It sort of flopped for me, but it was still a good film. But I think because everyone had said to me, oh, dude, this is epic. This is like storytelling at the max. And I just, I was kind of scared by it a little bit. Okay. But my fave is Hateful Eight. What's your fave, guys?
I can jump in on that. Yeah, because my favorite is probably between Hateful Eight and Kill Bill. Yes, Reservoir Dogs is amazing. Yes, Pulp Fiction is amazing. It is hard to choose a favorite, but Hateful Eight, I think it's probably one of the reasons why I really enjoyed Saw way back. When you have a story that takes place in one location, the story, the dialogue, and the performance has to be so goddamn good. And when they have just an abundance of characters and the setting is beautiful, like the cinematography, the lighting of everything, and the way it just all unfolds, I just absolutely love The Hateful Eight. It's one of my favorite movies by Tarantino.
Connor.
Sorry, I'm trying to be so quiet. Usually I cover up all the silence in any podcast with laughter. I'm actually the complete opposite to Zara. I have seen so many Tarantino films, but I've never actually seen Hateful Eight. But I know, shock horror. My favorite one is actually Inglourious Basterds, because it was my kind of first introduction to it without being this is what you should watch if you're going to watch Tarantino. And then everybody, quizzes you over Pulp Fiction 24/7. But Inglourious Basterds, have to be my one. Yeah.
I actually watched Inglourious Basterds 2 nights ago just to kind of remind myself of it. And I did enjoy it. It's fantastic. It is a great movie. Not my favorite, but I just
and there's a caveat. Yeah.
I was just gonna say, I love the scene where you've Michael Fassbender playing the kind of British spy, and they go down to the bar, the basement, they just have this whole scene where there's gonna be a gunfight, it's gonna explode. It's just that building tension right up to the moment where everybody dies.
Is that where he does the three?
Yes.
Yeah. He does instead of the his thumb. I love that
index,
scene. I thought that was so well done.
Finger three instead
he does
of
it like that.
Yeah, instead of the thumb instead index and middle. And that was enough to give him away. I thought he was being really ballsy begin with anyway, because he was speaking with such confidence and he was really being a dick.
And he got shot in the balls.
He did. Yep.
Hey.
But I love that scene. I love the way Tarantino just, what's going to happen. But Tarantino slowly built up to it
But
yeah, it's the Hitchcock thing.
I would say I'm probably just being a lot less like thoughtful around it. I was just probably like, because it was my first introduction to Christoph Waltz, who is just French kiss to cinema.
Oh my goodness.
Sorry.
French kiss. Oh,
beautiful. I mean, and then ever since, like, I mean, whether he's a good character or he's a bad character, that was my first introduction to him. And honestly, I mean, the man can do no wrong in my eyes. Like, just amazing actor and just such
his
a great
scene,
psychopath.
His opening scene where he comes into the dairy farm and he just has that glass of milk, and just the way he has such a command of the screen that I love, because I think when I first became aware of him was, I think, Django Unchained. Oh no, before that it might have been actually, it was that Seth Rogen movie. Green Hornet.
Oh yes,
he was in that.
Oh
yeah.
God.
I know. And it's not a great movie, but
what a cinematic
Christoph Waltz stood out for me.
What a masterpiece.
Yeah. But yeah, Django Unchained the first time I saw Christoph Waltz, and going from that to who he is in Inglourious Basterds was it was different.
My two favorites would probably be Kill Bill 1 and 2. I take them as like one movie because they kind of are.
Well, it's funny you say that actually, because Tarantino, so he says he's doing 10 movies. Mm-hmm. Technically, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, I think, was his 10th, but he counts Kill Bill Volume 1 and Volume 2 as one because he did a re-release.
They're so connected, yeah.
Yeah, and he called it, so you got Kill Bill 1, Kill Bill Volume 2, and then he has Kill Bill Double Bill, The Whole Bloody Affair, as one release. So I'd say he counts that as one, so his next movie will be his 10th and possibly last.
Yeah. My least favorite one that I've seen... Actually, you know, you just mentioned Once Upon a Time in the West, or whatever the fuck you call
Hollywood.
Whatever it's called. I don't know. I forget that movie because it was...
Sounds like you really loved it. I hate it.
I didn't like it as much.
Yeah, I was just so bored. I was just like, move on. Stop showing me feet, even though y'all at home should send me those feet pics, okay?
Get those feet pics in.
Yeah.
I didn't get it when we were watching it in the cinema. And then the friends that I was with, wow. Is English my first language?
You saw it with your friends in the cinema.
Other friends. Another time Sarah went to the cinema.
Another time in the West. Another time that I didn't bring Ryan or Joe.
It was probably far prior to this podcast, but still. I knew you, so...
It's okay. I have other friends.
I knew both of you in a way, like from projects. So anyway, yes, when I watched Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, I didn't get it. I didn't understand what was happening because I had no context, hadn't watched any trailers. And then the friend that I was with explained the whole kind of Sharon Tate and Charles Manson thing. And then retrospectively, I really enjoyed the film. But while I was watching it, I was very bored. I'd have to say I didn't really get what was going on or where he was going with any of the strands, but knowing Tarantino, I thought he's going to like bring this all together in some way and it's going to be magical. But yeah, I just didn't really.
It's not like there shouldn't really be for a film going in that you need to do like prior research and know the full context of something beforehand.
That's what my other friend said that we were with. He was like, I shouldn't have to like know all this other information.
Prior. Well, oh yes, sorry, yes, I see what you mean, Connor. Yes,
well,
yes.
Not
I mean,
post.
Post, it can be fun. I mean, you can leave a movie wanting to know more and then do research, which can be fun.
And then look it up, yeah.
Yeah, suppose I understand what you're saying. What
but that's the exact same thing. Like, I came out of it being like, yeah, I didn't really, like, understand. Like, you know, nothing really happened in the end of it. There was no, like, proper, like, climax other than, you know, obviously, spoiler alert, you know, fucking Brad Pitt, like, smashed by, like, I mean, when that dog got killed, tears. But my friend had to like complete, you know, I was like, what was that like all about? Like, I kind of got like, you know, some things happen in it. And she, like my friend Kiva, she's going to reshare it as well, turned around, we had to do the exact same thing and give me a history lesson and was like, well, this is Connor, read the title Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's clearly, you know, a reimagining of XYZ. And never had I felt more stupid leaving a movie before, but I paid for it, so I got my tuppence worth, I guess.
Thanks, Tarantino, for making us feel like idiots.
I just really didn't get the whole Sharon Tate thing. I mean, what was he trying to say with it? Like, that this woman shouldn't have been killed, and you're like, what does that got to do with anything?
Did anyone that's been, like, murdered? Been murdered? Yeah.
Did you know that he was going to reimagine the whole situation?
Well, yeah, because I knew about the Manson murders because, you know,
yes, but it was reimagined, wasn't it?
Researching serial killers. But yeah, it was reimagined. Yeah,
so there was that kind of shock value. Like you thought you knew what was going to happen and you didn't.
Yeah, I mean, you knew entirely there's going to be some sort of twist, but you know, the way he killed Hitler in Inglourious Basterds, spoilers for like a 10-year-old movie, but whatever. So yeah, you kind of knew that something like that was coming. I thought that was that, I don't know, they were going to like murder, what do you call him? Oh my God, he's one of my favorite actors, Leonardo DiCaprio. I thought that they were going to murder him in the movie. And, you know, it didn't. I mean, he set them on fire, which was fine. Good.
Yeah, true.
But I don't know. That movie just, no.
We do have to thank the movie for one thing, though. That meme of Leonardo DiCaprio, like, watching himself on the he's, like, pointing at the TV because he sees himself on the TV. And that's just, that spawned so many beautiful memes.
I have not seen that
which I share
meme.
Frequently.
I have not seen that.
Oh. I'll link
the only
it
one
to
I've seen is Leonardo DiCaprio in Django Unchained, where he has that wee smug face. So yeah, good. I love that.
Yeah.
I was just delighted that they gave Dakota Fanning a cameo in it as like some hillbilly wench in it. I was just like, this is stunning. Put her on the Manson farm. Like, this child does not age. In my head, she's still playing that wee girl from Cat in the Hat. But I mean, it's your
totally.
Own. Yeah. I like when the cinematic universe is minced together. This is like the reality of Cat in the Hat. Really, they're just like on drugs throughout the whole thing. And she's a child in the Manson.
She's,
you know,
grown up.
Yeah.
And at one point she was a vampire in Twilight, you know.
Yeah, exactly. I remember that. That was weird.
Yeah, there's some things you don't need to bring up.
I will always bring up Twilight.
Every chance.
Well, what do you guys think about the violence, the level of violence in Tarantino's movies?
Whenever I didn't know much about Tarantino and I saw trailers and people were discussing his work, I was kind of like, oh, a director who glamorizes violence, how new, how niche. Like, I just thought, oh, that's so like boring. I don't know. And then when I actually watched the way he did it, then I sort of enjoyed it. I really enjoyed all of the violence in it.
Like, there's something comical about it too, though. It's not always just gore.
There is.
For gore's
sake. Yeah, it's so over the top.
This is literally, I don't know if any of you guys like remember or if we were just kind of weird in school, but like, sorry, that exact question came up on my like GCSE like English language thing about this interview with Tarantino with like Christian Guy Murphy, you know, from Channel 4. Yeah. And it's like the big like thing being like, I'm shutting your butt down. That's why I just started laughing there. Cathartic violence, yeah, in Tarantino movies. Yeah. He's talked about it. He's mentioned every iota. You can't make me dance. I'm not one of your monkeys. Oh God, love that man.
Yeah, I mean, it's good that it was on a GCSE question because that's, you know, Ryan's level of things.
Wow.
I think I have control over who's in this show. I could just
kick him out, Ryan. Pick
Joe,
him.
Or yeah, I can just.
You're gonna shut my butt down.
Yeah, censorship. I have that power as a white man to censor Joe.
Sorry, I'm being extra sassy this evening because we've got a guest. I'm showing off.
I love it. I know. I love it.
This is a different show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, so different. I don't.
Like, we two guests on the show
on a regular basis.
Well, I love the violence in his movies. I really love the violence in his movies. I think what was a turning point for me was watching Kill Bill and that scene on the crazy idiot scene with Uma Thurman. Mm. She takes out everybody in such a just gory fashion, but beautiful. Loved it. It wasn't shot in black and white. In post, it was changed to black and white.
Yeah. Mm. For censorship purposes, yeah.
Yes. Thank you for taking my point, Joe. Yes. So for Asian audiences, they left it in color because they're used to that sort of thing. And then to maintain their R rating, they had to put it in black and white. In lieu of cutting the scene entirely or cutting large chunks of the scene out, they put it in black and white because then the blood, well, everything's black and white, everything's grayscale, so blood isn't red, you know, so it was a very interesting tactic, I thought.
Yeah. It was pretty stupid, like, I mean, really, because it's such over-the-top cartoonish violence that it's not really real. I mean, people getting their like arms cut off and blood going everywhere. It's like an anime. He was totally inspired by anime for Kill Bill because there was anime.
Well, it's his love of both Westerns and Asian, you know, movies and Kung Fu. And it's done for different audiences, I think, obviously. Yeah. But I mean, people watch that scene and think there's too much gore. Even watching Inglourious Basterds, the scene where, yes, the cinema's burning down and the two guys rush in, you know, to Hitler with machine guns, and then they shoot him, and then they cut back to the machine guns and they cut back to Hitler's face and you see his face being torn apart for like a split second. And I think a lot of people would think you didn't need to see that, but they threw it in anyway. But it's just one of those signatures. It's just a signature of a Tarantino movie. I think I feel like I know Tarantino-esque gore when I see gore. Mm. You know, there's gore in loads of movies, but I feel like if I seen his gore, I would know that it's one of his movies.
And I think if it was just done once, it would also be a little bit more like real or sort of disturbing. But because he does it all the time, it's like more familiar now to us and we kind of just laugh at it.
Yeah. As much as I love those movies, Uma Thurman cannot fight. Oh my God. I mean, she's so
Watched the video today of her car accident. That was kind of scary where she's driving along and she's like in the there's footage from behind because they filmed two versions of it. Tarantino said that he drove the route and checked that it was all fine. And then she got in the car and did the thing and it's on the camera must be on the like the back of the car. And you just see her like hit a tree and she kind of like holds her neck and it was really crazy. I didn't realize that was
physicality. No, I feel bad.
That's the reason why she can't fight.
It's no excuse, Uma Thurman. Power through it. Keanu Reeves did for The Matrix. He had like a neck injury.
True. Oh my God.
Michael, that big toe.
If that's where the bar is at, where you're literally comparing people's physicality to, you know, like Keanu Reeves.
Worst neck injury.
Jesus Christ. My God.
Know, right? If you're not Keanu Reeves, who are you?
Yeah. Get out of the industry.
I just think, you know what? You're talking about violence and all like this. And like, lost opportunity when this man, you know, is present in so many of his films. Like, it's kind of like Stan Lee, do you know what I mean? When he appears in like his Marvel movies. But like, surely if you're going to be a director and you're going to, you know, sprinkle yourself into films just as a little, you know, B-roll kind of thing, that is a perfect opportunity to just be like, I want myself to be like, you could experiment so many different ways to kill. Like, do you know what I mean? You're like, I want my head to explode. I want like my arm to get cut off in this scene. I feel like, do you know what? Like, if he's going to go all in, mate, fucking commit. Get you those some like, you know, some cool gifts of yourself with your like, you know, your body being torn apart into. I that's just my personal opinion. But
he did get blown up in Django, didn't he?
I was going to say, yeah, he got blown up with dynamite in Django. Yeah.
Well, there goes my uneducated answer.
Yeah, Connor, do your research, my God.
Well, it was one time, I guess. You know,
here's my hot
take. That one time he blew himself the fuck up. You know?
But his performance is woeful. Like, he should not be on screen. But that being said, if it's I weird, had his power, I'd
he
be on screen.
He was good in Pulp Fiction.
Yes.
That was the one I was thinking of that made me a bit uncomfortable. I don't know. There was something about his. He was okay in terms of acting, but just.
Yeah.
Being so aware that he's the director and everything that he's doing, he's also then watching back and being really...
Are you criticizing his performance more so?
Yeah. Must be weird.
That's how you know, again, you're watching a Tarantino movie. It's the gore. It's the fact that he's probably put himself in it. You know, what else? The dialogue.
Soundtracks, music.
Soundtracks. I love...
He's always got sort of
the
like...
Feet.
Yeah,
always
feet.
The feet. Yeah.
Really is the fucking feet. I mean, Jesus Christ.
Do you know how
where
actually...
I got my fetish from? Just watching Tarantino over and over again.
Maybe that was it. Could be it.
It was Kill Bill. That's why Joe says that's his favorite, because she's sitting there wiggling her big toe.
No, he'll want yours, Joe.
Girl.
It doesn't work if you're
I
both.
Got good feet. I got it. What'd that foot do?
What'd that foot not do?
Isn't it similar as well to like the guy that apparently like runs, you know, Nickelodeon, that like kids channel? Like, apparently his big thing is like there's a whole like conspiracy theory about like him loving feet as well. I don't know if you've yet, even
really?
If you see like, yeah, the Nickelodeon like symbol itself or like their logo is a child's foot. And in so many of like Nickelodeon things, or whether it's like iCarly or do you know what I mean? Like all those kind of things. They are used so prominently with children, but like, yeah, I remember I was going through some like Twitter feed where somebody brought up Tarantino's feet and they're like, hold on a second, you guys don't know about the guy that literally runs Nickelodeon. And now I'm convinced that Tarantino now runs Nickelodeon, but yeah, that's my new conspiracy theory.
Illuminati 2021.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
I am looking at the Nickelodeon logo and one of them just a big splatter effect, but one of them I suppose you could argue is like a foot. But it's very,
it's
very
it's all in the subtleties. Do you know what I mean? If you're a child, what are you seeing, huh? Yeah.
So true.
Well, I thought it was interesting that, was it Zara, when you said about the music, Tarantino uses the music to write the scripts. So he'll go through his record collection and then he'll go through tens, hundreds, I don't know, of songs until he finds something that really just kind of inspires him. And then he'll just play that song as he's writing the script and it helps him set up the scene. So then he's writing the scene.
That's a really good way to do it.
The actual composition. So I thought that was really, really cool.
That is really cool. I like that.
Well, that's probably why it has such good beats. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. As you say, like it's written to beats and it really seems like he's thought about it from a music video point of way sometimes.
It's not how you can like aggravated Baby Driver as well. Apparently he just like finds like soundtracks. Mm. He's like, yep, let's make this completely work. But I knew he did Tarantino. That was like his hotel. Maybe, you know what? They're all copying each other anyways. Somebody fucking be original for a hot second.
That's Jesus. True. Also, Edgar Wright was on a podcast with Quentin Tarantino. So.
Ooh.
Wow.
I mean, the parallels in this universe, crazy, crazy, crazy.
In a crossover is just unreal.
Two people in the same industry talking to each other on a podcast? Wow.
It should be banned. Yeah. Crazy.
Again, Illuminati 2021. We've
confirmed it. Definitely is. It has to be.
Trump 2024. Okay.
I thought it was going to be Kanye West.
I heard it's The Rock.
Ooh,
yeah. Imagine. Rock, yeah.
You know what? I would love to see Arnold Schwarzenegger as president. I don't care if he's not allowed to be president. I would love to see Arnold Schwarzenegger.
It'd be really
president.
Cool.
Yeah.
At this stage, do you know what? It's already like it. Where else can you go with it? Like, nobody's really going to be surprised at this stage. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
Tarantino.
I thought you were going to say at this stage, like, who couldn't be president? Like,
yeah. Well, they should just do a fucking X Factor for the presidency, you know?
They should. Yeah, why not? Oh, Hunger Games for the presidency.
Yes.
Yes. Love it. That's brilliant.
We've just hit gold, guys.
Probably Hunger Games for the next guest on our show.
Yeah, probably.
You know, so Connor, you're gonna have to go back into a Hunger Games scenario and then come back on the show if you survive.
Oh, exciting. Mm-hmm. Well, like, do I just like wrap
up? How are your survival skills?
Minimal to non-existent.
Great.
I quite literally talk to people on the internet, that's my hobby. So, like, I mean, can you I put that into practice?
Yeah, convince them to commit suicide.
Oh yeah, exactly. That's why my listeners like drop every single week, apparently. Yeah, that's what
we'll just make sure that this episode's a good episode just in case you don't come back.
Yeah, yeah, just in case.
But I've
just
in
your memory.
You. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've all earned our position here except for Zara. She was just told she could come on.
Yeah, just because I'm a girl. That's the only reason I'm here.
Wouldn't have been fair.
What would
to
be your strategy for surviving the Hunger Games?
Ooh,
see, I think I would be really good at that. We've had this discussion before where I think I would thrive in a zombie apocalypse.
Yeah, but it's the Hunger Games.
You would. You're like really prepared for that. I feel like I would like manipulate everyone to be my friend by like just being like the charming person I am. And then
if you side with me, I may show you one boob.
I may just pop a nipple out. So stay tuned. You know what I mean?
Yeah. That was my strategy. I would go off on my own and just look at the cameras and be like, some of this. Yeah, send me
showing
stuff.
Your feet.
Send me stuff. What do you want? You want this? Or do you
what do
want
you want?
Feet?
What do you want? You want some thigh?
You want? Because it's all good, but just what you like. What you like? You know. So that's what I would do. That would be my strategy.
That would be really
sponsors.
Good. Sponsors get sponsors. Yeah. I would climb a tree and cry.
Oh.
I would like to say I'd like equally try to, you know, pop a nipple, but I've been trying that for years and to no, you know, value at all. It's been
really
strange. I know. Oh. I know it's quite strange, apparently. But that's why I decided to just go podcast route, because I'm like, I'm going to, should it be nipples for radio or a podcast? That's what I like to say. Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good
just
saying.
Just don't do it in real life. Mm.
What's your favorite Tarantino-ism?
So many isms.
Are you asking a question or are you?
It's a real question. It's a real segue.
I just did a segue. Yes, Joe, give us your favorite ism.
Yes, start.
I know I mentioned feet quite a lot, but you know, no. I don't know. I mean, I like whenever E does the over-the-top dialogue. I like that. That's such a Tarantino-ism. One of my favorite scenes is from, is it Kill Bill 2, where they're facing off in the caravan against each other. They have the samurai swords and they're like, I killed your master. And it's like right up to their eyes and you're like, oh. It's so
is that after
pure,
she,
like samurai, old Western anime cheese.
And then she comes back to the caravan later, doesn't she? And then that happens.
Oh, that's such a good scene, yeah.
I think my favorite ism is, yeah, I was going to say like just how playful he is as a director and that he doesn't take things too seriously, even if they are like a serious topic. I quite like that. I don't know, there's something really freeing about watching something and it's kind of a little bit serious, but you can kind of have a little giggle at it, or at least not a giggle, but like a feel like you don't have to be really stoic and like uptight about it. I don't know, you can just kind of be like playful, and so I really like that he just doesn't take things too seriously and just kind of like has fun.
He's just a fun guy. Yeah, we like that about
Tarantino.
Doesn't take anything too seriously. He's easy to get along with. Do you know what I mean? Bed around for tea.
Yeah, Yeah. My Connor, tell us your answer. You better be serious.
While I was frantically scrolling through my phone there to look up Tarantino-isms, I was trying to find somebody else's answer that make mine a bit more eloquent. No, I think it kind of draws along the line, same lines as Czar, where it is, it kind of, I feel like he's given a lot of liberty in films that, like, if anybody else tried to do it, they'd just be like, piss off, do you know what I mean? You can't be like getting away with, you know, just making things like so strange. Like, I mean, Reservoir Dogs, you know, like dance around this guy while he's literally dropping, like, you know, isn't it petrol or like lighter fluid? I was like stuck in the middle with you. Like, there's little like things that just happen in his films like that, or where it's Uma Thurman, John Travolta, you know, like dancing, like just really strange little scenes that do they add to the story at all, or can they be like, will the story work without them happening there? Do you know what I mean? Like, I kind of really enjoy that about him. There's something like a bit childish that I kind of, yeah, I appreciate it. And speaks to my inner child. But in terms of other isms, I'm not sure. I mean, the fault one, I know, Joe, that is something that you're taking claim over. I'd just like to,
you know,
Christ.
I like a muscular foot.
That's the exact same. That's the exact response.
Yeah. Just the kind of childless little fancy that he kind of brings up, and as well, just that kind of reimagining of historical events. That again, I think I mentioned this. I had no idea that that was like his whole thing with Inglourious Basterds, with Django and Jade. Like, didn't cap on at all that this was just a reimagining of history. So then it makes you feel a little clever. Yeah, that's what I like. Brings it down to my level. Yeah.
And you, Ryan, what's your favorite Tarantino-ism?
As someone that, okay.
Which one?
Firstly, I just really enjoy his camera work. I think his cinematography is one of the main reasons why I loved Kill Bill. It's why I love any of his movies, I suppose, especially Hateful Eight. I love the color palettes used. I just love everything about his cinematography and his movies. As well as that, just the dialogue. Like, I really enjoy when you have like a serious moment or something's about to happen, and then you just have characters who are just talking about stuff that's nonsensical, just silly conversations that seem nonsensical, but there's a purpose for it. And that Tarantino says that it's used as a device to make the characters more relatable. Like, if you're looking at Pulp Fiction, you're looking at the Hitmen, you're looking at, you know, if they're having random conversations, it kind of just makes it more personal. It just makes it more, just easier to relate to, just more, I don't know, dimensional, rather than these are just hitmen or these are just bad guys. And I really enjoy that they are the types of conversations I think every day people have.
Yeah.
You know, just nonsense. And you would think that, why would these characters be any different? You know,
exactly. I like what you said about the sort of trope of having like good characters that have badness in them, or vice versa. Didn't Tarantino mention somewhere that one of his big influences or one of his favorite films growing up was The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly? Wow, let's try that again. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly.
Yeah, you can really see it.
So this sort of idea of having multifaceted characters and them being, as you say, more relatable or more like real life, because they're not just a villain that's only ever bad and who only has dialogue that's very dramatic or whatever it is. But I really like that he does that. He kind of brings in all those different sides to people and shows that multi-formed being, which is quite cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's that kind of playfulness that he has as well. I think it's all kind of interconnected, because there's like such stupidity in his films, shall we say, you know, where he just goes, I'm just gonna blow somebody up. But then there's really, really tense scenes. Connor, didn't you say your favorite was Inglourious Basterds? It's not my favorite one, but it does actually have my favorite Tarantino scene, which is that bar scene with Michael Fassbender. I think it's class. Now, I think the film goes a bit off the rails in the second half after that, but, you know, that's for another day. But I really like the tension in that scene, because some parts of that film are so silly and ridiculous, but because he's able to play with tone so well, he's able to just create this crazy tension. He does use that, I sort of said, the Hitchcockian technique, where he shows the bomb under the table, and you're waiting for the bomb to go off. And that's far more tense than just going, you know, shit, there's a bomb there.
That's going to go off. You just know it is. One, because it's a Tarantino movie.
Especially with his tangent-y dialogue. Scene.
Like, but I love that Tarantino takes his movies and splits them up into chapters. And each chapter essentially takes a different character or a different scenario and just lets it play out for another half an hour. and then it may later on then just come back into the kind of the main plot. But I love that he's not afraid to just kind of linger on a scene or linger on his dialogue or linger on a camera shot. And I think that that's something that only comes from being masterful at what you do.
Do you think he kind of qualifies under that, like, kind of that whole debate about like an auteur? Like, do you think he like qualifies under that now?
Ooh, or I knew you were gonna say
or, I don't know, like I feel like it's a reference point being like, oh, that's very Tarantino-y, you know, even like at this point. Anna, sorry, I'm literally like in this essay I would write.
No, but I like, think because I think he does come under that. Even though that's we've all kind of studied that and it's a little bit like overdone now, but I know what you mean. Yeah, even talking about his isms, like having different things that you can associate with one person, is really cool. And I think actually what he said about, because he said he only wanted to do 10 films and he really wanted to focus on those 10 stories or those 10 projects. He said, you know, a lot of other directors will take on side projects or take on other people's work or do things in the meantime. And he said he really likes to just really be sharp on what he wants to do and really focus in on and give most of his attention and time to these scripts and these castings and different things. So I thought that was really interesting the way he said that.
He has assisted on other
and his screenplay and
they're just not necessarily his, but I think it was I think it was he wrote Natural Born Killers and True Romance and he was happy with True Romance but disliked Oliver Stone's Natural Born Killers. It was after that then that he decided that I'm going to take command of my own projects and nobody else is going to do it for me.
Well, that was a formative thing then that happened to him. Him seeing his work maybe done like not the way he would do it. And then he's thinking, I'm going to take charge and make it completely my vision, which he totally has done.
Well done, Connor, brilliant. Bringing in auteur theory.
Well done.
That's your first podcast. You're very welcome. I like to bring a little something to show, a little spice it up.
A little substance.
I mean, I was just like, I'll throw in one thing that maybe make me sound like less of a stupid old. Don't know if it really worked because I literally just posed the question to everybody else. But the reason I kind of like brought it up is because I think he's kind of almost get to that stage of, you know, Wes Anderson or, you know, that stage of in terms of like he's using like the No. But I mean, Michael in terms Bay of like using like the same kind of even the same actors and his things like. Returning characters or returning, you know, actors at least that like I just appreciate whenever there seems to be this weird, you know, thing between an actor's like our director having like favorite, you know, people to just star their films. And it's just, I think there's something that like happens in that where it like turns over, like where you just like kind of expect to see them in it now. Like, I mean, like I said, like DiCaprio, Samuel
it's like
Jackson.
It's like an Adam Sandler movie. You know, you used to kind of see that collection of people in Adam Sandler movies. You know,
that group.
And if you liked that group, then you'd need to go and see any of his movies because you would have Adam Sandler or Rob Schneider or Kevin James. You would have the usual suspects.
Kevin James.
You know, so it is nice that in more, you know, higher quality standard, you've got Tarantino's group of friends and you generally know who you're getting in a movie, which is good because if you enjoy his previous works and, you know, you enjoy the actors, then you're always going to go and support his movies.
I was going to ask, do you think there's like anybody that like would fit well into that kind of like friend group that he's like obviously got in like his picket line of like, who will I cast? That kind
good
of way.
Question.
Like,
I think Emma Stone.
I think so too. Ooh. Have you guys seen the trailer for Cruella?
I did the other day, actually, I think it looked really good.
She definitely, it's very Birds of Prey, wasn't it? She quirky.
Yeah, because she's quirky.
You'll not watch it though, will you? Because you hate Disney.
She got that look. Emma Stone? Emma Stone's not in Disney, is she?
Well, Cruella is Disney.
Oh,
yeah.
She's dead to me now.
She gone. Bye, Emma.
Bye, Emma. Sorry, I really enjoyed your filmography thus far.
Up till now.
I would just love the cinematic universe where Meryl Streep becomes like a staple in like Tarantino films. Like really just piss up the bus. Yeah,
oh,
literally.
Would be amazing.
Do you know what I mean? Imagine her like shooting up some like Nazis and stuff like this and like Inglourious Basterds. I just love the idea of like them. It's kind of like, you know, if he's going to be weird, why not just go full weird into like, do you know what I mean? That's just personally, I'm putting it out there, putting it out into the universe. If it manifests,
Meryl
it does.
Street.
And let's just say, what
Meryl
harm
Streep
can
Nazi
do?
Hunter. Yeah.
Yeah, there we go. That's the new film. That's the 10th film, guys. There you go. Yeah.
The Devil Wears Meryl Streep's Nazi
Just
Prada.
Speaking of the Devil Wears Prada, I would like to see Steve Tucci.
Anne Hathaway. Oh, Stanley Tucci. Yeah.
Stanley Tucci, sorry.
Oh. Yeah. He's fine. I
really like him.
Yes, he is really good. I think he'd be fantastic in a Tarantino movie.
He would be.
You know who I think would be good, like as a really dry character? I mentioned him recently because he's in everything that I watch for some reason, but Timothée Chalamet.
I knew you were going to say.
He's just in everything.
I'm like, he was in every movie.
But he would be good because he's so dry and in like a really good way. And I think he would fit well into like a Tarantino kind of universe.
He's already been claimed by like the Wes Anderson world, hasn't he? With this like new one that he's coming out in.
Yeah. He's just so good, little Timothy.
Little Timothy.
But then sure, he was in like, as well, isn't this a whole thing with like Timothée Chalamet and Saoirse Ronan as well have now been like, been cast in like multiple roles with like Lady Bird and like Little Women. What you call it? Isn't it that female directors are?
Greta
Come
Gerwig.
On, I'm giving you.
Oh, Greta Gerwig, sorry. Yeah. Sorry, yeah. I didn't think you were asking about Little Women. Director. I thought you were asking about else that he'd been in.
Yeah.
New. Sorry.
No,
oh
no,
my
no.
God, that's like one of my favorites. That's terrible.
Yeah.
Sorry. I was trying to think of other people that could be in a Tarantino film that you wouldn't expect to be in a Tarantino film. That's where my mind was going.
James Corden.
I still haven't really.
The cast of Cats put in Tarantino. Man, just killed in a Tarantino film
right away.
Idris Elba. Oh my goodness. What about Tommy Maguire though?
Little Tommy.
He would fit in perfectly. Sorry.
Or like Daniel Radcliffe.
Spider-Man 2, isn't it, where he gets like this bad boy kind of thing going on?
Oh, that's the third one. Yeah, where he's like an emo.
Yeah,
and
he looks like Teddy Lang.
It gives it like a solid like 4.8 in IMDb because of that scene alone. Has where it he got tries a 4.8? Oh, I'm probably making up stats now, but
so
I mean,
bad,
I would
I love
personally,
it.
I would put it as a 4.8 if even like.
I'd put it as a 9.2.
Yeah. I mean, that's one. If you watch it as a comedy, it gets better.
It's very comedic. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh,
wait, Christ. It's not a comedy?
Wait, what? I thought Seth Rogen wrote that shit.
Somebody was high writing it, like
for sure.
Okay. I got a question for y'all. Here we go. So I said that, and this was like a rumor for a while that, what do you call him? Fuck Tarantino. We're just talking about him.
Has everyone like lost their minds tonight?
Wee Quinty. He was going to direct a Star Trek movie for a while.
Oh yes, we've talked about this
yes,
10 times.
So if Tarantino or Wee Quinty, as I'm now calling him, because I'm best friends with him, just like your best friends with Christopher Nolan, Sarah, you know, we're making friends.
We will get
if he could
Quentin
direct
Tarantino
a pre-existing franchise, what would you have him direct?
Ooh.
A pre-existing
good
franchise.
Question.
Yeah.
But he's going to have his spin on it, obviously.
Yeah, you'll have his
Tarantino-esque. Okay, yeah. Right.
It can be a book or whatever, you know, something that hasn't been turned into a movie. But
oh, interesting.
50 Shades
Shrek.
Of Grey.
50 Shades of
Grey. Oh my God, that'd be terrifying.
Yeah. Did you say Shrek?
Yeah.
As an animation or a live action?
I mean, each their own.
Practical effects.
Do with what he will. I mean, I just would love the Shrek trilogy. Triply. How many movies have
I? Do like four or five or something?
Yeah.
Maybe. And then we got a hit.
My goodness.
You know what I mean? Like, imagine the weird sex scenes between Donkey and Dragon that he would really go into.
He would go into that too.
Oh, absolutely.
How many people would be burned alive during the dragon?
Fiona would be up in that tower,
exposition,
you know, going, taking lines constantly every two scenes. Like, Princess Charming would definitely be like a psychopath that, like, you know, Ted Bundy kind of styles
yeah,
a serial killer.
Like a serial
do you know
killer.
What I mean? Absolutely.
I wonder how Shrek like looked like in comparison to Fiona. You know, when Shrek is the ogre and Fiona is human.
Oh,
you know, and then she's falling for this big beast.
Tarantino would definitely be like playing live action
yeah,
Shrek.
He'd have like mushrooms like, growing out of his skin
yeah.
and everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Because he's like, exactly.
And guys, the grandmother could be played, the fairy, is it the fairy godmother? She could be played by Meryl Streep.
She could be played
guys,
by Meryl Streep.
Guys,
we've got this.
We've
done this. Yep.
Absolutely. I mean, there we go.
Quentin Tarantino to film Shrek. Yes. The Shrek
text. Shrek and Tino.
Shrek's volume 1 and 2.
Shrek
and
Tino. Oh,
Shrek and Tino.
Oh, that's incredible.
Brilliant. We've done it.
Wow.
Sorry to just drop mic dropping everybody there.
Is there a better answer than that? I don't even think I want to give an answer. I was thinking of like Lord of the Rings, but that's just stupid now that we've talked about Shrek.
Yeah. You know what I would like, even though I think that the movie is nearly perfect anyway, but I would be interested to see his spin on it, American Psycho.
Ooh.
Interesting.
Oh, that yeah. would be, that would be a movie.
One of my favorite
I feel
films.
Like it would be similar to how it is now. But with
yeah, I think it would be like way more stylized though.
Yeah, way more stylized, way more playful.
Favorite films, Connor?
Yeah, my two favorite films, American Psycho and American Beauty. I mean, kind of like
very different films.
Yeah, very different.
Kind of problematic, maybe about like my mindset. But I remember those were the ones that I watched. Where I was like, I study cinema.
yeah, those are very cinema.
American
yeah.
Psycho is definitely one of my favorite films. So you can stay, Connor. You can stay. It's fine. You drink sparkling water. You like American Psycho. You can
absolutely.
Stay.
Thank you yeah. so much.
Ryan, you still have to prove yourself.
I have to prove myself every week. Yes.
Every week.
Every single week.
You're hanging on yeah. by this much.
What if they tuck them into like the universe? Sorry, I'm just loving this idea of like putting them in really odd, like, you know, like bits of authority. What if he's put into a universe of like, do you know that like the whether when they make like Dr. Seuss kind of like you know, stories into like films? Like what if he did, you know, The Grinch? What if he did Horton Hears a Who? Like Tarantino? Like I mean,
the
I
Grinch
think
saves motherfucking Christmas.
What if you did Cat in the Hat?
Yeah,
I love it. I love it.
Oh my goodness!
Say he would
be
that.
The cat
would
in the hat.
Grinch. Yes, he would.
He would yeah. play the.
Yeah. I understand. Oh, I see opportunity here. I mean, Dakota yeah. Fanning already been using one. Do you know what I mean? I already see the links are coming through here. Timothy Chalamet, he could fit into that universe.
He could yeah, be the brother.
Exactly. Yeah. Tobey Maguire could even fit into that. It ticks all the boxes. Come
it writes itself. It writes itself.
It really does. It already has. Oh, yeah. Wow.
We just need to send Joe, I'll edit this podcast. I'll give the podcast to you. You mm-hmm. give it to your best friend.
My mate, Quentin
Tarantino. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We Quentin.
Which is actually really, so Zara's ex-lover is Christopher Nolan, but they've broken mm-hmm. up now, so let's not talk about that.
That's a very good way to
now we've just
describe him.
Confirmed that Quentin Tarantino is Joe O'Hagan's best friend.
And current lover.
And current, okay.
And possible lover.
And we've yet to divulge who my best friend slash movie lover may be.
I'm really excited yeah, to find
stay
out.
Stay tuned.
I think it's Tommy McGuire.
You may never know. It could be Tommy McGuire. No, it'll be somebody else. Somebody better. Somebody better. I can do better.
It's Spider-Man. You can do better. Nope. You can do better.
Let's
Ryan.
Not forget
right.
I am Batman.
Confidence is key. Yeah.
Yeah. You may never find that person, but it's good that you're holding out for them.
It's good that's that you know cool. they're out there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
I don't pop my cherry for just anybody.
You're
that's
to
true.
The question.
And you shouldn't. You shouldn't. It's a yeah. special thing.
It's a special thing. Hold on to
and
your
this segues perfectly into the sponsor of this week's show, Durex. Never pop your cherry until you're ready. Yeah.
Durex or Duracell? I always get those two confused.
Hey,
I mean, they're both used. Yes. Yes,
yeah,
I agree. They're both.
I would say turbo power.
They both have a place in their bedroom. Uh huh.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah. Oh, they do.
They just they're just used by different things. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I used to work at a petrol station, and you know, you'd get a gentleman coming in. He's like, "And I'll have some condoms." And I'm like, "Yep." Or no, sorry, no. He'd say, "Sorry, like, and I'll have some Durex." And I'm like, "Yes, of course." And I would instinctively reach for the Duracell batteries and go, "Oh wait, no." And then
like,
comes the,
like reach for like cigarettes
yeah,
or something.
And then comes the awkward conversation of and which. Which kind?
Oh right, yeah. Which the, one?
Do you want
safe,
one with
the hole
poked in it or not?
You know, I mean, feather light. and like, oh, just whatever you want. Oh, okay, yeah. I'll give you the ribbed. You know, say
oh,
that's what we, tell her she's welcome.
Depends what you're into. Maybe they're taking that as a suggestion.
Just yeah, you were handed over, you're, Ryan. You just winked and said,
"Yep."
So sorry. After that large tangent, mm-hmm. what film would you have him direct, or what series would you have him direct?
Oh, I mean. Harry Potter.
Oh, yeah. No, I
yes.
disagree. No, you would not want a Tarantino movie. You wouldn't want a Harry Potter movie.
Harry's head would fucking explode.
I wouldn't mind, right? Because we've already got the Harry Potter films. We can watch them and enjoy them anytime we want.
No. I don't think that's what Joe was saying.
Whoa.
It's not that he's. What are you saying, Joe? If he were to take
the
franchise moving forward, or
Tarantino's
film replaces.
Either, you know, we can sort of redo it if he wants to do it, or he can take it forward if he wants to take it forward. But you know, Harry as an auror, blowing people's heads up.
I vote for a rewrite. I think this is stunning. Yeah.
Get JK Rowling out of the franchise. She's a turf. Get her the
bye,
fuck.
Bye, JK.
It's
bye,
also
you're problematic now.
It's not sat in like Hogwarts isn't like this, like, you know, otherworldly school. It's kind of like, you know, like proper
mental,
like,
asylum.
Yes, that's yes. what I see. It's a warehouse, yeah, out in West Hollywood.
Amazing.
And they're all
yeah.
field actors.
But we don't but know
like,
that until the end of the movie yes. that it's an asylum and
yes.
they're all insane.
Exactly.
Yes. Oh, wow.
Yep.
Wow.
It's inhabited by yeah. one person who's envisioning everything. It's yeah. all a lie.
Oh, this is good. This is good.
It's all Ron Weasley's wank fantasy.
Oh, we Ron.
Yeah, we Ron. We Rupert Grint.
We Rupert Grint. Do you know he actually came into my petrol station once I used to work in?
Did he buy some condoms?
But I'd taken that day off and then he came in. I was raging.
Oh, no way. Yeah. That's crazy.
That's like the equivalent to I sold the lottery ticket and my, like, do you know what I mean? Where I work is
your
like,
numbers
oh, did you win
up,
it?
Yeah.
It's like, no, but like it was there. So like, it's kind of like a cool story.
It's kind of like I won it for them.
You can yeah. still, yeah, you can still tell the story and be like, meh.
Yeah, exactly. Fuck you, Connor.
It's like whenever it's like when people post up on Facebook about like if there's been a big world disaster and then they check in as being safe and it's like, do you know what? Like it could have happened because I was there a year
you're
ago.
From Ardoin.
Yes.
Oh my god, people are like, yeah. I went there on holiday in 2017.
Checked in a safe in Ardoin, Jesus Christ.
Could you imagine? We almost booked that year.
Oh. Okay, Karen.
I went on holiday there yes. when I was 5. Jesus.
Oh my god, you just don't know. It really does. You just don't know.
I'm so sorry. I feel like I just shat all over Rand's like regret story.
No, not
it's okay.
At all.
I deserve to be shat on.
You did, but it's okay.
Well, that was it. I made my point. Good. That was yeah. the story. That was it.
You got a story out.
I wasn't in, and he came in, and that's the story.
Unreal.
Yep.
It happens.
That riveting.
That was real life.
That was
cool.
Real
that was pretty cool.
Get it? yes, I don't know actually why I would have Tarantino because I wouldn't. I don't think I would want him to touch any.
I've got one
of
for
my
you,
beloved.
Ryan.
I don't want him touching Star Wars. I'm not saying he couldn't do a good job, but I don't think I want him to change Star Wars. I don't want him to
and
change
you're gonna cry,
Rocky.
Ryan. It's going to make you cry.
Yes, tell me.
Okay, you ready?
Yeah. Enlighten
Toy Story.
No. Ooh. No. Yes. She's saying not Connor because I have yes. Toy Story behind me.
He loves Toy Story. He loves Buzz.
What does Andy's mom do with Woody?
What does anybody do with wood? I'm sure it would be very interesting, but I would not. I don't know. I think I would want him to take on an underdog story, something I'm not that interested in or aware of, and then have him wow me with it. And then I become a fan.
Oh,
like Twilight.
So something that you've been kind of unimpressed
something
with
shit
in the
like
past.
Twilight, make it
Twilight.
Oh,
or,
wow.
Or the Hobbit,
come on, Joe.
Like the Hobbit trilogy. Maybe he could actually do it some justice.
Yeah, the Hobbit trilogy was shit. Oh my
wow.
god.
Wow. That would be
the
really
highlight
good.
Of the Hobbit trilogy for me was whenever I went to see it in the cinema and a kid burped at the opening credits.
What a moment.
That was good for me. I liked that. I was like, well done. That's all the praise this film deserves.
My only other one would have been like, who would have, you know, directed his films if he didn't? Because it was not like a thing that it was going to be that like Scott Newton or somebody, other film director was supposed to. Is it technically somebody else directed like Pulp Fiction or like over him? Because he did like Full Romance or something else. I can't remember. I was scrolling through my phone quite quickly trying to like come up with random ideas. But I mean, who else would like be able to like take over that world that
well,
he's created?
From Dusk Till Dawn was written by Quentin Tarantino. But filmed by Robert Rodriguez.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So it's a great movie. I do enjoy it. I mean, Selma Hayek. But I know. Let me just shift in my chair.
She is crazy rich.
Like, yeah, oh but I mean, it doesn't feel like it was shot Tarantino-esque. Do you know what I mean? Like it feels like a Tarantino movie, but it doesn't feel like a Tarantino movie, and that is partially because he wrote it, maybe wasn't obviously there to direct it, and that's what you get. You know, still a good movie as long as the script is good. But
well, I mean, you could say the same of True Romance. Then you could
exactly,
say that it has a lot of, as we say, isms of
well,
Tarantino.
Oliver Stone's
but...
Natural Born Killers. Sorry, that's what Tarantino didn't like.
And Scorsese right. could direct Reservoir Dogs.
Ooh, yeah.
Probably could.
Yeah, he's got that kind of heightened reality thing going on.
I think Tim Burton could take a decent whack at it, you know, really fun.
Yeah. Everybody can be really white and pale.
Tim Burton has a new movie coming out. What a franchise is he taking? What's he doing
franchise
next?
Is he trying to ruin now?
I've seen it.
I just love the idea of like maybe in Ghostbusters or Django Unchained being done by Tim Burton, but it's just like the characters are all really like Elvin Bon Carter, do you know what I mean, or Johnny Depp, but they're just really pernickety, and it'd be like, oh, sorry, you know, like that very like dainty kind of style like sits through into it. Like it just completely disrupts the whole storyline. Like
nothing can be Jimmy Fox.
Wednesday.
Hello, Starshine.
He's family. In a series. Adam's Family. Yeah.
Oh, well, yeah, that suits him.
That's right up his alley.
It does. It's very gothic. That's cool. Mm.
I would have presumed that would have been probably somebody by what's called Ran Murphy. I would have thought that would have been kind of like up his alley a little bit.
Ooh.
Like Glee Ran Murphy?
As in, yeah, American Horror Story, Ran Murphy has gone war down if he's going to do Wednesday Addams. But yeah, Glee Ran Murphy.
But yeah, Wednesday Addams could have like, you know, a little musical number. It's fine. Mm. Yeah.
I'm just a small town girl. Just have that in the middle of Django or something.
Why am I bringing all of these Django universes into just some kind of musical setting? Yeah. Maybe that's my contribution.
Maybe that's your calling in life. Again.
Maybe, yeah. Now, I know you've tried to do like restylish, you know, different like movies or whatever like this. Have you ever thought musicals?
Yeah. Django and Chim.
Have you ever thought Shrek?
I love the Shrek idea. The Shrek idea has
it's
to happen.
So good.
I like that too.
Joe, make that happen.
I will. Don't worry. I'll tell Quentin.
Yeah. Me Quinty Poo.
Yeah.
Quinty.
Whenever I've got him gagged up and stuff, you know, I'm like, Quentin, listen, I've got a really good idea for you. Okay. It's not like the other ones I've had where you've shook your head and went, no,
don't do that to me.
It's Shrek. Okay. You can direct Shrek.
You've got this. I've even written this.
Your career has been leading up to this moment.
Yeah. This is the pinnacle.
Need the call, Quentin.
This is Dream the time.
It really take another kind of tone with all that.
We're going to have to start a campaign and a hashtag to get this off the ground.
Yeah, we've got to start this hashtag.
Mm-hmm. Hashtag QT for Shrek.
QT for Shrek.
Hank got really takes us to the end.
I think it does.
Hank got really just sums it up, guys.
Hank got does. So, so what have we learned this week? Foot fetishes. Tarantinoisms. Connor interviews people on his podcast, Finterviews. So do tune in to his podcast. Have a wee listen. See him interview people. And maybe I'll be on it at one point. Who knows? Just saying. So thank you for listening this week. And thank you, Connor, for joining us. Do you want to say some closing words?
Yeah, thank you so much for having me on.
Don't even thank him after that. Just tell him to pass off.
I was like that was just the most energetic kind of like, I suppose, caller came on. And then I realized, I did kind of use up your podcast time to talk about like the weird things that I'd do with like Shrek if Tarantino was involved. So a complete deserve. But no, honestly, thank you very much for letting me play out my fantasies on Popper, and I really appreciate it. And let me sit back for a hot second and not have to be interviewed, but like let my crazy flow out for a minute. So appreciate being a guest on the show, guys.
Oh,
you're welcome, Connor.
Thank you so much.
Anytime.
We loved having you.
Yep.
Loved having you too. And thank you for being a bit more highbrow.
Yes. Yes. After the podcast, I'll make sure that you pay your fee for being on here.
Yeah.
Well, that's how we do things here. We don't pay you. You pay us.
I get you. And if anybody would like to send in an invoice, you can get me on socials on Facebook and Twitter at Finterviews Podcast and Finterviews Pod. Thank you so much.
Shameless plugs. We love it.
Thanks for plugging your show, you capitalist.
Yep.
And while Connor is shamelessly plugging himself, we'll plug ourselves. Go follow us on Instagram, Facebook. Now we've got a Twitter, so go tweet at us.
Woo-hoo.
No bad things. I welcome criticism. I just don't want it. This has been Joe. Bye. I'm Zara.
Bye.
Ryan.
Bye-bye.
Bye. See you next time on 8-Bit Popcorn.